Jump back into Galatians. Any questions from scripture or theology in general that we can go over?
I don't know if I have a question, but I was reading where they lived, just Adam and Eve, and how long they lived, and then their kids, you know, it was shocking.
Yeah.
They lived to be like 900 years old.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a very interesting thing. And we're going to be jumping into Genesis sometime. After our time in Galatians, we're going to go to 1 Peter. But then after that, at the request of you all, we're going to go to Genesis, which, well, I'll just be consistent with every book that we study and say it's one of my favorite books. And it really is. But that is one of those things that's very difficult to wrap our heads around. And there's some interesting answers to that. I won't go into great detail now, but I'll just say that whatever it is, it shouldn't cause us to doubt. And not that you are, but I know there's people that read some of the things in Genesis, especially the first few chapters, and they really struggle with it. And one of them is the age of these patriarchs and matriarchs who lived hundreds of years. Well, what are we to do with that? There's lots of different ways. It could very well be that they did live that long. It could very well be that it was really marking the age of them and their descendants, like a house. People don't normally like that. The language doesn't necessarily support that as much, but that is a possibility. The other possibility is that it could very well be that the way that they account for years and life was different. So we don't know. We don't know. You know, the argument is also that after the flood, when God allowed for there to be wrath spilled on the earth and for all to perish except for one family, that from there, people's lives were very different. And so they didn't live as long. So that's an interesting way of looking at it too. There's no perfect answer, but we will get into that in more detail when we get to Genesis.
I just want to know.
Well, here's my common response, and I do apologize if I say this all the time, but I'm going to ask you a couple of basic questions. Do we believe in God? Well, by definition, is there anything impossible for God? No. So when I read something in scripture that doesn't seem to line up with my experience, then either I need to say, okay, that's just because that's my limited experience, or I just don't really understand it, what it's saying, which could be a possibility. But what I do know is this, that if God is real, then all things are possible. And that's it. That's what we have to do. And that may seem too simple for some people, but again, if I believe that there is a God and he's revealed himself through Jesus Christ, and I believe then that he's revealed himself here, then I'm comforted by that. And I'm a very skeptical person by nature. So, yeah. Anybody else? Before we jump back into Galatians, any questions? It could be about anything.
So I was reading, I've been reading a lot of the books, and I just like, I was struggling with it a little bit about how women got treated. Sure, sure. They were offered up men, yeah, virgins were concubines. Yeah, time and again, women were treated as, yeah, it helps comfort it because it helps me trust the Bible because it's going to report
the
good.
Yeah, you know, that's really a good point that Araceli just made, in that when we compare the Bible to other religious texts, even not just other religious texts, but also other ancient histories, that the Bible is pretty unique in that it really, it tells things that would otherwise be really embarrassing. If you look, in fact, it's so interesting. If we look at all of the great men and women of the Old Testament, you are hard pressed to find any of them without serious problems. And I think, and I had a professor basically say it this way. It was like they were all just shadows of what is to come. Like the good men of, like a great man, a man like David, the king. You're like, yeah, there's so much to like there, but man, he just fails so much because he's not the one. He's small in Messiah. He is an anointed one, but he's not the one. And we're going to talk about that a little bit with the law and how, you know, God has been revealing himself to humanity from the very beginning. And there was all this plan leading up to this perfect revelation of God in the God-man, Jesus Christ. And all of these people leading up to that, these types of Christ, these types of Messiahs, who could point to some good things that we can emulate, but ultimately to show us that even the greatest among us are just miserable without God. The greatest among us are not worthy to be our Savior or worthy to be worshiped. It highlights just how good and awesome Jesus is. Because when Jesus shows up, he isn't like anyone else. He is a prophet, he is a priest, he is a king. And that's why when we read that earlier, he's from the order of Melchizedek, right? Not in the line of Aaron or Levi, not like all of these ones to come before, but different. Yeah, it's the Bible does not pull punches. We see the great, when you talk to Jews, if you ask them who are the greatest people ever lived, they're going to say somebody like Moses. Moses didn't even get to go into the promised land. Think about that. Is that not amazing? This was a friend of God. There was no one closer to God we could find in the Old Testament than Moses. I mean, it's just, he was so close to God. He was constantly before God. His face was glowing when he would come down from the mountain, and he couldn't enter the promised land. Think about that. Abraham, the great man of faith, who we're about to read about. We read about last week, we're going to read about again. Lied about his own sister. Yeah. I mean, come on. I mean, his wife lied about his wife to the Pharaoh. I mean, come on. I mean, time and time again, they just failed. They're miserable. David, his whole family had to be destroyed basically because of his sin. This is the great day. This is David. This is God's man. And he was wanting to build the temple of God. And what did God say? Nope. You spilled too much blood. Your son can, but you can't. Isn't that amazing? Like, that's amazing to me. So they're all types. They're all leading up to Jesus. And Jesus is just, yes.
It's comforting because, I mean, if they were so great, then, you know, God spoke to them very clearly.
That's exactly right. I think that's exactly right. And that is definitely one of the great lessons, right? I mean, going back to Moses, God's call on Moses. What did Moses keep saying? No, not me. Not me. I mean, not me. I got problems. I can't do this. And he does. How many times does God choose barren women to bless and bring about great men? Over and over and over again, right? God chooses those that men wouldn't choose.
Second born.
Say again?
Second born.
Yeah, yeah. That happens a lot too, right? I mean, it's so cool. God, to God be the glory. We never should confuse that. Which also, anytime you have a Muslim or Jew or anybody that's talking about, yeah, but the worship of Jesus, it's like it doesn't jive with it. It's like, that's exactly right. Because he's not a prophet, just a prophet. He's not just a man. How could Jews who were so dedicated to believing in Yahweh, the one and only God, worship Jesus unless they saw in him God? Yes, capital M. He is different. When he comes, even though he fulfills hundreds of prophecies, and if they were really in tune with the Spirit, they would have recognized him, but they didn't. Because even though he met every expectation, he also was what they were not expecting. So cool. So cool. Which ties into Galatians in that we said, What did we say before? What was one of Paul's questions? If we can go back, we're in chapter 3. Remember our basic outline. Okay, our basic outline. We could split Galatians into thirds. The first third is autobiographical. It's personal. We find from the first two chapters that Paul had an encounter with God, that his authority comes from God, specifically from the Lord Jesus Christ. But he's also aligned with the pillars of the faith. James, Peter, John, met with them, aligned with them. Speaking to the Galatians, Gentiles from places like Lystra, Derbe, Iconium, Antioch, Pisidian, revealed to them the gospel. They believed. Through their faith, they were saved. But now these Judaizers come in. And so in this autobiographical portion, he explains why their gospel isn't the gospel. The Judaizers isn't. Because they're saying, yes, to worship Jesus is okay, but it's Jesus plus, and then it doesn't matter what you say after the word plus, it's wrong. We are saved by God's grace. What do you do to earn grace? You don't. That's the definition of it. We are saved by God's grace through faith in Jesus and only Jesus. And so the simple, beautiful gospel is now being polluted. And so in the autobiographical portion, Paul mentions his encounter with Peter. And we see even great men of the faith make mistakes. It's also encouraging to me because it doesn't seem like Peter and Paul make a lot of mistakes. And I don't know if we'll call this a mistake, but we know that Paul had an issue. He and Barnabas got into a fight, didn't they? And they split up. It happens. We see that Peter was tempted when people came from James, those that belonged to the party of the Pharisees, to act Jewish, to break faith with the Gentiles that he had become friendly with. And right there we saw that this isn't just a theological issue, though it's important enough to be one, but this also has to deal with unity. Just like we saw in the book of James, how important it is that we are one church. Which, by the way, a quick aside, I don't know what needs to happen, but I'm just convinced that there are revival is coming to where Protestants, Catholics, Orthodox, where we can put aside at least the petty differences and we can come together again. It may only happen as Daryl's been preaching through Revelation when Christ returns. Maybe that's the event. But man, it's so sad the splintering that has occurred. But that is why it is so important that we saw in chapter 2, and that led into chapter 3, that Paul had to confront Peter. It was so important because he was seeing the division. So the two, if we want to boil it down to the two reasons why Galatians is written, the most important is to talk about the liberty, the freedom we have in Christ and only in Christ, that salvation only comes by grace through faith in Jesus, nothing else, nothing else. That's number one. Number two, through the gospel, there is unity. All we have to do is look around us. We have people from different ages, different backgrounds. We don't all look alike, but we're all brought together in a building in Garland, Texas. Why? Because we have the same Savior. Isn't that cool? Isn't that so awesome? So awesome. So those are the first two chapters, the autobiographical portion that leads into the argument. He uses the illustration with Peter to make the argument with the Galatians. Hey, if I'm going to stand up to Peter, because even he was tempted to be a hypocrite and think that, you know, you have to be Jewish, then it's worthy for me to stand up for you right now. And then we get to the middle section, which we're in now. This is the doctrinal section, the real theological section of chapter 3 and 4. And then we'll see some practical examples in the final two chapters. So we read the beginning of chapter 3 last week. I'm going to quickly read over it, and then we're going to transition to the next part of chapter 3. You foolish Galatians. Remember, that's one of these things that says it's pretty vigorous, blunt, direct, brief. You foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Before your very eyes, Jesus Christ was clearly portrayed as crucified. What does he mean there? Through his own preaching He made it very plain what had happened to Christ. Through his preaching, they saw the gospel. I would like to learn just one thing from you. And he's gonna say he wants to learn one thing, and he does want to know one thing, but he has a lot of great questions. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by believing what you heard? What's the obvious answer? By believing. Verse 3. Are you so foolish? After beginning by means of the Spirit, you are now trying to finish by means of the flesh? Isn't that interesting? He's like, hey, you came to believe through faith. That saved you. Why would you go backwards to that which does not? Have you experienced so much in vain or for nothing, if it really was in vain, if it really was for nothing? So again, I ask you, does God give you his Spirit and work miracles among you by works of the law or by your believing what you heard? What's the answer? Believing what you heard. By the way, what miracles among them? Were miracles performed? Yeah, probably, absolutely. But what is the one miracle that we all have shared in that he is talking about right now? Salvation. That we who are sinners, guilty, very guilty, we're about to find out that's one of the great purposes of the law. We are utterly unclean. But by what Jesus did on the cross and God's grace poured out to me when I believe that Jesus is who he said he is, the great miracle of our miracles, God looks at me and sees a child, his own. That's amazing. That's amazing. And as a result of that miracle, what does our pastor say all the time? This life is the what? This is the worst it's going to get for us because there's only paradise to come. How great is that? And he's going to be preaching about that here more. So there's one great miracle right there. Verse 7, understand, verse 6. So also Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness. So we have that first mention of Abraham and we're going to get back to him. Understand then that those who have faith are children of Abraham. Scripture foresaw that God would justify. This is a very important word. It's used a lot in Galatians, and it's also used a lot in the New Testament. It's used about 30 times. Justify the Gentiles by faith. Who are the Gentiles? Non-Jews, right? Those are the Galatians, the people he's talking to. By faith, and announce the gospel in advance to Abraham. And then he's going to quote Genesis here. All nations will be blessed through you. So those who rely on faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. So he talked about experience, then he talked about Abraham as an example, and then now, as we talked about last week, he's going to quote from the law and the prophets. For all who rely on the works of the law are under a curse, as it is written, curses everyone who does not continue to do what? What's it say? Verse 10? Curses everyone who does not do all, everything written in the book of the law. And that's just it, people. We can't be sort of good law followers. It is all or it is nothing. Now think about that. And remember what Jesus had to say about our thoughts. So are you a lawbreaker? How much of a lawbreaker are you? Well, according to what Paul is saying here, as he quotes the law itself, as he quotes the Old Testament, what he would consider scripture, we are breakers of all of the law. Man, that's bad news. Except it leads to the best of news. Curse is everyone who does not continue to do everything written in the book of the law. Clearly, no one who relies on the law is justified before God. What did he say again? Clearly, no one who relies on the law. Why is he writing this to the Galatians? People came in after him and Barnabas were there, and they're saying, yeah, okay, you have faith in Jesus, that's great, but now you need to circumcise. Now you need to follow the law. Now you need to become Jewish in order to be a Christian. And what does he say right here? Clearly, no one who relies on the law is, what's that word again? And what's justified mean again? Just as if I never sinned. It's a legal term. It's basically saying innocent. It's different than sanctification. It doesn't mean that you're now holy. It just means you're innocent. And right here, Paul, like a knife to the Judaizers' argument, clearly no one who relies on the law is justified before God because, and here we go, we have Habakkuk, the righteous will live by what? Faith. The law is not based on faith. On the contrary, it says the person who does these things will live by them. Do, not believe. Verse 13, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. And here's the gospel. For it is written, cursed is everyone who is hung on a pole. He redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles. How? Through the law? No, through Christ Jesus. And then here it is again. So that by what? Faith, we might receive the promise of the Spirit. Now, why does the promise of the Spirit come in here? First of all, the Trinitarian language should not be overlooked. It's a lot of people, it is said, even 2,000 years later, after all the great work that has been done on the doctrine of Trinity, we still have people who are claiming to be Christians who do not believe in the Trinity. I'm sorry, you're not a Christian, period, end of story. It's all the way throughout. You're like, well, the word Trinity is not in the Bible. Yeah, sure, the word's not in the Bible, but it's there. We see it all over the place. In this section alone, we've got God, Jesus, and the Spirit here. Here. And what is the promise of the Spirit? It's the seal of the Spirit of salvation. And this is what's so amazing about the gospel. It's the already not yet idea of it. I'm still in this earthly body. I'm still surrounded by fallen creatures under constant attack from fallen angels. That reality is always the case. But you and I, when we put our faith in Jesus, the Holy Spirit indwells us, and we are now sealed. We are promised for the life to come. Isn't that cool? So that's what we read last week. Those are the three quick, brief arguments that he had. How did you come to know the gospel? How did you come to know Jesus? It was by faith, your own personal experience. Hey, what about Abraham? He came before the law, and he was credited righteous. How? Through faith. And then he quotes the very law itself to say, hey, if you're not following the whole law, you're cursed. You can't be righteous through the law. In fact, it's just the opposite. Through the law, you are cursed. Praise be to Jesus who took the curse for us so that we might be redeemed. How do we know? Because we're promised by the Spirit. Isn't that good? That's good news right there. And now we get to one of the hardest passages in all of the New Testament. I shouldn't say it quite that way, but it's dense. It's thick. Here we go. Why then the law? That's a question that every Christian should basically ask themselves. Why the law? All right, it's all about faith in Jesus. I'm with you. Why the law? Here we go. Verse 15. I'm going to read it all without stopping since this is our first time reading it, and then we'll go back. Verse 15. We'll go to about 22. Brothers and sisters, let me take an example from everyday life. Just as no one can set aside or add to a human covenant that has been duly established, so it is in this case. The promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. Scripture does not say, and to seeds, meaning many people, but and to your seed, meaning one person who is Christ. What I mean is this, the law introduced 430 years later does not set aside the covenant previously established by God and thus do away with the promise. For if the inheritance depends on the law, then it no longer depends on the promise. But God in his grace gave it to Abraham through a promise. Why then was the law given at all? It was added because of transgressions until the seed to whom the promise referred had come. The law was given through angels and entrusted to a mediator. A mediator, however, implies more than one party, but God is one. Is the law, therefore, opposed to the promises of God? Absolutely not. For if a law had been given that could impart life, then righteousness would certainly have come by the law. But Scripture has locked up everything under the control of sin, so that what was promised, being given through faith in Jesus Christ, might be given to those who believe. I'm going to go ahead and read a couple more verses. Before the coming of this faith, we were held in custody under the law, locked up until the faith that was to come would be revealed. So the law was our guardian until Christ came, that we might be justified by faith. Now that this faith has come, we are no longer under a guardian. So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Now, before I jump into it, what strikes you in that section we just read? Basically, the balance of chapter 3. Anything seem odd or anything stand out? All right. Well, let's go to it. Let's get into it. Verse 15, brothers and sisters, let me make an example from everyday life. Just as no one can set aside or add to a human covenant that has been duly established, so it is in this case. So he's talking to them. He's like, and covenants were known at this time. In the first century, for sure. Covenants have been around for a lot longer than that. These basic agreements between people, all sorts of covenants existed in the ancient world, just like they do now. We don't usually use the word covenant. What might be another word that we may use today? Contract, what else? A promise. How about vows? All right, that's a basic covenant agreement. So yeah, all the time. And so he's trying to say, think about a human covenant. Well, now we have one with God. So if we have a human covenant that we can't add, subtract to, the covenant is a covenant, it's a contract, period, then isn't it even more the case that when God makes a promise, that we can bet on that promise is going to be what it is, that we're not going to add and subtract to that? So he goes back to Abraham. The promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. Now, we can even go back farther. He doesn't make the argument here, but where have we heard this language of seed before? Genesis chapter 3, right? The proto-evangelion, like the first witness of the gospel. Remember, what does it say of the woman? And the seed, her seed, says seed of a woman, which, by the way, is really weird. You never say seed of a woman. Unless it could be the seed of a virgin woman. It says the seed of the woman will do what to the serpent? Crush. Arch its heel, and the serpent will do what? Strike. Bruise, strike, bruise at his heel. Yes. And so we see this foreshadowing even all the way back then, right? But going back to Abraham, the promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. Scripture does not say and to seeds. Meaning people, but to your seed, meaning one person who is Christ. Wow, Paul just did a huge lift. And if we don't stop, we might just go right through it. But he basically is making a connection to these Gentiles, what is true to Gentiles and Jews both. And that is going all the way back to the promise of Abraham. Remember, God says this, he go all the way back to Genesis chapter 12 and move forward. This promise to Abraham. Why? Because he was a man of what? Man of what? Man of what?
Faith.
Man of faith. And so these promises are now going to apply to the seed. And then from the seed, all peoples will be blessed. You remember that in Genesis? Doesn't say just the Jews. It says all people will be blessed. Scripture does not say into seeds, meaning one, but meaning many people, but to your seeds, meaning one, the person who is Christ. What I mean is this. The law introduced 430 years later does not set aside the covenant previously established by God, the one through Abraham, the man of faith, and thus do away with the promise. For if the inheritance depends on the law, meaning and not the promise, then it no longer depends on the promise, but God in his grace gave it to Abraham through a promise. Yeah.
I've never made that connection before, but this seed of Abraham went the same thing as the seed of Eve. the scripture doesn't say to his children as if it meant many descendants. Rather, it says to his child.
Yeah.
Which I never.
And what does Matthew do that Luke doesn't do? What's Matthew's genealogy all about?
Through the woman, isn't it?
What connects Jesus to who? To Abraham.
Oh,
yeah. He's the fulfillment. He's all these things, man. You and I, we read, if we're not careful, we just blast through them, right? Again, Melchizedek, who comes up again in Hebrews, the genealogy that we see. It's the importance of their connecting Jesus to the original promise of God. Jesus is not plan B. He is plan A and has always been plan A, and there is no other plan, period. I think sometimes we have this notion that God tried with the law, just didn't work out. Nope. And that's what Paul is about to get to right now. But God in his grace gave it to Abraham through a promise. Again, Abraham is the man of faith. Paul's going to make this argument again in Romans. It's not about your bloodline. It's about your faith line. Who are you connected by your faith? Going all the way back to the one and only God, Yahweh, who has expressed himself in the God-man, Jesus Christ. Verse 19, why then was the law given at all? Man, what a great question. Paul is anticipating that question. And it's a question that we should all ask. It was added because of transgressions. It's another word we could say for transgressions. Sin, law breaking. All right, that's a good way of saying it. Every time you speed, that's a transgression. There is a law, you break it. Transgression. Until the seed. Now, by the way, my Bible capitalizes seed. It's a little, I'm glad that it does because it's telling us who we're talking about, but that's not really capitalized. But we do know who it is based on what he just said two verses earlier. To whom the promise referred had come. The law was given through, now this is so interesting. The law was given through angels and entrusted to a mediator. A mediator, however, implies more than one party, but God is one. I'll be honest with you. Verse 20, it's one of the hardest verses I've ever read. That is a confusing verse. One commentator that I read said that there is as many interpretations as verse 20 as there are as years between Abraham and the law, meaning 430. Got Pastor Darrell.
Craig, does that just mean messenger?
No. Just the verse, though. What's the verse mean? No, it does mean messenger. But what's the verse? I'll read it again. And I appreciate, by the way, Timothy George, which I'll probably quote from him in a second, his New American Century or New Century American, I'm going to say it wrong, commentator, he's great on this. He's got a lot of good stuff here. So if you want to go look it up, go look it up. A mediator, however, implies more than one party, but God is one. So the question is who's the mediator? Careful. Calvin, Origen, they said Jesus. But is it Jesus? We'll go back and read very closely. And now you can see why there's an interesting thing here. The law was given how? Through angels. To who? To who? Moses. The mediator has got to be Moses here. It's the only thing that makes the most sense. Now, are there other places where Jesus is described as a mediator? Absolutely. He's a mediator between God and man. He's the God-man. Here, that doesn't work out too well for us. Because if we say that it's Jesus, then what are we saying here? The law was given through angels and then entrusted to Jesus? The law was? That doesn't make sense. It makes more sense to say the law was given through angels and entrusted to a mediator, that mediator being Moses. A mediator, however, implies more than one party, but God is one. Well, then what do we mean by that? Hey, Barbara, hey, we just prayed for you. You feeling any better? What an answer. What an answer. Yes, we'll continue to pray. Yes. Sorry about that. So what is this? Most likely, and this is, I welcome you to tell me otherwise, but I think there's a comparison being made here, I think is what Paul is doing here. We have the law that was entrusted to angels, meaning it had to go to many. It was entrusted to a mediator, Moses. But now let's look at what has come through faith. God is one. He is the completer of this promise. Think about it. How are we saved? Did you do anything? What does the law imply? Right, but what's the... Yeah, it's a contract between who and who?
Me and my father.
Between us and God, right? What's the theme of Leviticus? Be holy because I'm holy. Well, how? Here's the law. But we utterly fail at it, right? Now think about the original promise through Abraham that Jesus accomplishes. Who made the covenant? Who completed the covenant? What's our part in it? We don't have a part in it. God is one. He's the beginning and the end of that covenant. There's no amount of human effort a part of that promise. I think that's what Paul's saying there.
What's the hang up on the, I'm still lost on what the hang up on the verse is. Like, what, why is it so?
Because a lot of people think the mediator means Jesus there.
Oh.
Because of the language that Paul uses in other places.
Are we talking about and just specifically the law or like God's word? Like, because I mean, if you.
Well, see, that gets interesting later because we're going to see where it says scripture several times here. And scripture, I think, well, I should be careful when I say I think, like I have original thoughts. In my reading, there's a lot of people that would see the word scripture when he's about to read it as euphemistic for the law in totality. Because when he says the word scripture here, this is all Old Testament, all Hebrew. He's not meaning anything that he's writing, that Peter's writing. He's talking about the law.
Because if there was... Oh,
sorry. No, go ahead. Finish your thought and then I'll...
If there was, because God spoke to... Isaiah, he spoke to, you know, Elijah.
Yeah.
So I would just, if I'm not, educated in this, but I would say that I just see this manifold coming down from heaven from God's word that goes to prophets that are mediators.
Yeah.
But it all, like, one of the arguments for Islam is like, it's only in Arabic and it's only this.
Yeah.
And that's what they live and die by that argument. I think it's powerful that, God speaks to his people through his word. In the way that they are, So I would almost say that he's reaching down through time. He's reaching down through Latin and Arabic, or not, whatever. Like he's to me, you've got an abstraction of something infinitely complex where he's giving fragments of who he, his nature.
It's more powerful to you because of the multiplicity of the way that he's revealed himself.
Correct.
He didn't pick one dude and that was it.
Correct.
It's a problem with Islam. It's a problem with what else? Mormons, right? And their belief. One golden tablet came down. We got the one guy. He wrote it down. That's great. But what do we have? We have multiple interactions with God, with people all over the world throughout hundreds, if not thousands of years, all aligning in the same message.
But Paul's point here is to create, like, this is really personal. My daughter, don't repeat this, my daughter took Luke's Pokemon cards and gave them to school to be cool. It's so weird. And she, like, there's all this external pressure that she's to be baptized, and it's like a cultural pressure. And I'm like, I'm going to think that means saying no. She said, and she doesn't understand it. And now all of a sudden she has all this remorse, like she's sinned. I'm trying to, there's the conviction of a seven-year-old, right? But then it's like, the standard is, this is why it's sin, because these are the lines, you painted outside of the lines, she doesn't know any of that. So, but Paul's point is like, everyone's painted outside the lines, everyone's missed the target. So, he's not referring to... He is specifically referring to like the Ten Commandments.
Yes, end of that sentence. I would add to that it is the law in totality. That he's saying all of it. All of it is convicting all of us of sin at all times. That we're not close. It's like that illustration that I heard an evangelist give. He's like, all right, take a rock, throw it to the moon. All of you take a rock and throw it to the moon. All right. Roy may throw it farther than me, but we are all ridiculously not even close to the moon. It's not even close. So some might get a little bit higher than another, but we all, in grand scale comparison, are not even close. That's sin. And he's using the law to say, well, actually, let's just keep reading because it's going to answer it itself, actually. Why then was law given? Oh, sorry. Let me make sure. What I mean is this, the law introduced 430 years later does not set aside the covenant previously established by God and thus do away with the promise. So by having the law, we don't get rid of the promise that comes by faith. That's always been the case. What does he say in Hosea? Does he want sacrifice? What does he want? Personal. And what type of heart? Contrite heart. How do you have a contrite heart unless you know that you are wrong? It's not about what you do. It's about the faith that is behind working the law. It's always about faith. Later does not set aside the covenant previously established by God and thus do away with the promise. For if the inheritance depends on the law, then it no longer depends on the promise. But God in his grace gave it to Abraham through a promise. He's saying, hey, if it can come by means of the law, he never would have had to make the promise to begin with. The promise would have been the promise coming of the law, but it wasn't. It was of the seed, singular, of Abraham. Why then was the law given at all? It was added because of transgressions until the seed to whom the promise referred had come. The law has given through angels and entrusted to a mediator, Moses. A mediator, however, implies many parties, which was true of the law. It was, just as Paul said, it did come through different people. It came through Moses. It was repeated in Deuteronomy. That just means second law. All the law and the prophets, it never got away from that. It was always there. People still had to go to the temple at least once a year to provide sacrifice, to atone for their what? Sins. How do they know they sinned? The law. And here it is. Is the law therefore opposed to God's promises? No, absolutely not. For if the law had been given that could impart life, then righteousness would certainly have come by the law. But scripture, and that's where he says scripture, and again, I believe in with others that he's meaning the totality of the law, has locked up everything under the control of sin so that what was promised being given through faith in Jesus Christ might be given to those who believe. What does he mean? You know what the law is really good at doing? What's the law really good at doing? Yeah, I want to read a quote to you that I think is pretty good. We'll probably end here. We'll get into more of this next week. Yeah, this is really good. The problem is not the law, but our sinful disobedience that the law brings to light and further exacerbates in order to show us how hopeless we are apart from the imposition of divine grace. I want to read something else to you. This is it, man. Had Paul concluded his statement with the description of the law as an instrument of imprisonment and condemnation, then the human situation would indeed be bleak beyond all hope. However, just as the law enters that it might fail, so too it condemns that it might save. And how did the law perform this strange work? By so provoking transgressions, by so exposing human wickedness to the scrutiny of divine holiness, by so eliminating every avenue of self-justification that the sinner is drawn, conscience-stricken and impoverished to the only place where authentic redemption and liberation can be found. The law was there. There's three illustrations. I'm not going to have time to get into all of them, but he says there as a jailkeeper. We're going to see later as a pedagogue, an instructor, a tutor. The law performs this work. Listen, don't think that if there was no law that we wouldn't be sinners. Like, man, thanks for giving us the law. Now I'm a sinner. No. We were already sinners. The law is that physician that tells you how sick you are and how in desperate need you are of a savior. The law makes it so clear that there's no amount of good that you and I can do to get the favor of God. There's nothing I can do, as I fall from Roy's gift, there's nothing I can do that makes what Jesus did on the cross, nothing I don't need. The law exposes my depravity, it exposes my wickedness, my twistedness. it shows so completely and utterly what a failure I am. And as a result, how sweet the gospel is. And now you see why this is a big deal for Paul, that he's hearing these Gentiles who were saved by believing in Jesus Christ were now hearing that they had to circumcise themselves. They had to go back to the tutor when the Savior had already been shown to them. You can see it, right? And we too have to be so careful. Listen, we should be doing good works. Absolutely. Works is a part of the equation. We are saved, what? To do good works. But we should never confuse what we do with equating to getting the salvation, the promise, the Spirit. Our gospel should be complete, and it should be the simple truth that we are all sinners in need of God's grace. And the only avenue to God's grace is through Jesus, by believing in Him, the one that had been promised from the very beginning, that the law was exposing our sin and in need of. The law was a conduit to send us to the Savior. Why would we ever go back to it? Amen? We'll get to the rest of next week.